please stand firm. I will release a bigger heart to you and a bigger love to you. So wait for this time in this coming year. Philippians 3 verse 20, for our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. I believe that in the future you will live in the heavenly realm, even more so than you live on the earthly dimension. I see that your heavenly reality will be even more real to you than your earthly realities. This is a season when the heaven is so much closer to you than the earth, and Jesus is closest to you than ever before. God is training you, see how our church, to open your eyes even more, for you to live out the heavenlies on this earth even more so. And I believe that to win this situation, it's not just a battle that's in the earthly realm, but you live as if your heart and your soul and your thoughts are residing in heaven, while your physical body is here on earth. Romans 5 verse 2, through whom also we have access by faith into this grace in which we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. And not only that, but we also glory in tribulations, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance, and perseverance character, and character hope. Now hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. Let's just give God a big clap of praise. I believe we're coming to a new season. God's presence, God's power, oh, God's reality is going to be more real than the earthly dimension. God is taking us into a supernatural realm in 2017. Come on, let's give Him praise tonight.
Praise God. Welcome everyone to Physical Ministries. Let's give Him the highest praise. Sit with us as we worship. Holy Spirit is here. Just raise up your voice. Hallelujah. Watching, God is going to touch you. because Holy Spirit is here in this place.
Praise God. That was awesome worship. Thank you all for joining us live. We could go even deeper into worship, but we're going to just get into the Word of God today. We welcome everyone watching live. Thank you for joining us. We're back here in Toronto, Canada on a Sunday afternoon, January 6, 2019. We just came back from a nice vacation trip down to Dallas, Texas, and we're so thankful and grateful for a time of worship at Upper Room Church, where their vision is experiencing the presence of God morning, noon, and night. Praise God. And I was so grateful to be there and see that there's another church who has implemented the vision of Third Heaven Ministries. We believe we're heading in the same direction. So we thank you all for joining us live. We're going to be coming to you a lot more often in this year through social media. Praise God. Father, we thank you for this day. This is the day you have made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you for the presence, for your power, for your anointing, for the excitement in the air, Lord God. This is a new season and a new time for many people watching. I hear the Lord say, rise up, mount up with wings like eagles. Many of you watching, this is your time and your season. It's a new beginning and a new season for many people. Not because it's a new year, but because you're putting your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And he is your new season, your new beginning. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And step out by faith. I hear God saying, God is saying he's an infinite God, infinite power, infinite in might. All things are possible for those who believe. And nothing is impossible for this awesome, mighty God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He's just there waiting for you to take your step of faith. And he will back you up. Just as Peter cried out to the Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ, said, if that is you walking on the water, call me out. And the Lord said, yes, it is me. And he called Peter out of the boat, walking on the water. Keep your eyes fixed and focused on the light of the world, the author and finisher of our faith, Yeshua HaMashiach, the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega, the one who is, who was, and who is to come. Hallelujah. Praise God. It's an exciting year. I just feel an excitement in the air because of the fact, like I said, not because it's 2019, but because we're in year 5,779 in the Hebrew calendar. We're already 4 months into the biblical year, which started on Rosh Hashanah in September timeframe on our calendar. And so again, I believe that there's so much exciting stuff happening because when you put your mind, when you think in your mind that it's a new beginning, you start acting, your behavior changes according to what you think, and that's biblical as well. As a man thinks in his heart, so is he. So again, the fact that we're treating January as the first month of the year, which is true on our calendar, the Gregorian calendar, I believe we've started this year in September, October timeframe, and we're gonna keep it going with signs, wonders, and miracles. The reason I'm so excited is that it's nice to take 1 week off, and I kind of thought Texas would be a little warmer, by the way. I wasn't sure if I should wear a long sleeve shirt or a short sleeve, and we get off the plane, and I had to have my winter jacket on. It was colder than Toronto, my God, but praise God, I think it warmed up after we left, but Toronto has been pretty good this year. We had a little bit of snow, not much. But we were down to about 34 degrees Fahrenheit in Dallas, Texas. I was so surprised. I thought after a 2 or 3 hour flight south, it'd be a lot warmer. But anyway, praise God. I believe I just got healed of this little a cough and cold that I picked up a few days ago. And I very rarely get sick. But the fire of God came during worship today. And I feel it has burned everything out of my lungs. Hallelujah. I declare healing for everyone watching today. I rebuke all sickness, all disease. No infirmity, all viruses burn out of you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. I believe that's a healing for anyone who needs it today. Praise God. We're going on to dreams and visions. This is a series. This is part one of a series. It's going to be at least three. I usually do three-part series because there's so much to cover in the Word of God. Let's open up to, praise God. Where are we going to start here? There's so much to cover. Let's open up to Deuteronomy 13, 1 and 3. And as we go there, I just want to say that, you know, our vision for Third Heaven has always been the same, but I believe God has given me more revelation in this last week than in the last 10 years of ministry. And so get ready. I'm not going to share it all today, But gradually, as we move through the month of January, and we do our 21-day Daniel fast, by the way, which starts tomorrow, if anyone who's interested, fruit and vegetable and water fast for the next 21 days, starting tomorrow, January 7th, right to the end of January. And great things will happen if you participate in this fast. And if you're not used to long fasts, you can do maybe a 12-hour fast instead of 24-hour. Or like I said, Daniel fast is not a full fast. You can still eat fruits, vegetables, and drink water and tea or whatever you need to sustain you. But it's important to be in prayer in the Word of God over these next 21 days. And you'll see great revelations coming forward. But I believe God has already given it to us. And I'm going to release more about the vision of where Third Heaven is going this year. Let's turn to Numbers chapter 12. Praise God. Numbers chapter 12, verse 4 to 6. It says, "At once the Lord said to Moses, 'Aaron and Miriam, come out of the tent of meeting, all three of you.' So the three of them went out, and the Lord came down in the pillar of cloud. He stood at the entrance to the tent and summoned Aaron and Miriam. When the two of them stepped forward, he said, 'Listen to my words. When there is a prophet among you, I, the Lord, reveal myself to them in visions. I speak to them in dreams.'" Praise God. This chapter is so powerful, but I'm not going to cover that today. Numbers chapter 12, I just want to show you that in verse 6, the Lord says that when there's a prophet among you, I, the Lord, will reveal myself to them in visions. Everyone say visions. And speak to them in dreams. Praise God. So I just want to give you the biblical reason why we're going to spend a lot of time on dreams and visions this month, because there's so much to cover, and that's the main way God speaks to a lot of people. Of course, during those, through those dreams and visions, he will use his word to speak to us. But let's turn to Acts chapter 2, and you'll see why this is the main way God is going to speak to us in these days. That's a spiritual language, that's a heavenly language, dreams and visions. It says in Acts chapter 2, verse 17, "In the last days," by the way, we're in the last days. This is part of the revelation God is showing me, is that get ready for some more blood moons this year. I believe in a few weeks here in January, we're going to get more blood moons. And these are all signs and wonders in the sky of the soon coming King, the return of the Messiah. He's coming back to Jerusalem. The Mount of Olives will split in half, my God. You're in for some great times, but keep your eyes fixed and focused on Israel. By the way, we pray for the peace of Jerusalem. We bless Israel. Those who bless Israel shall be blessed. Amen? That's God's chosen land and people. And it says here, "In the last days I will pour out my spirit on" who? "On all people." Everyone say, on all people. "Both Jew and Gentile." It says, "Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see" what? "Visions." Everyone say visions. "And your old men will dream" what? "Dreams." Praise God. And it says, "Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy." So again, dreams and visions and prophecy all go hand in hand. And I'm going to focus a lot on dreams today, and then maybe visions next week, because like I said, there's so much to cover. But let's just jump to 2 Corinthians while we're still here in the New Testament. And I want to show you the vision that Paul had, because our whole ministry, Third Heaven Ministries, came from a vision that God showed me several years ago and then confirmed it. And so again, God speaks to me many times in dreams, in visions. My wife is very good at interpreting dreams. So if you ever have a dream and you're wondering what it means, give us a call. The number is right there, and we'll pray into it and interpret the dream for you, because that's what God used Joseph and Daniel in the Old Testament to interpret the dreams for the pharaohs, for the leaders, and that actually promoted them. My God, I'm jumping ahead here, but Joseph was promoted from the prison cell to the palace. My God, from the prison to the palace. Why? Because he was an interpreter of dreams. That was a gift God gave him. And so the butler and the baker in the jail cell knew that Joseph could interpret their dreams. So they told Pharaoh, and Pharaoh had a dream about the 7-year famine in Egypt and the 7-year of plenty. And so he called upon Joseph to interpret the dream, and that elevated him to second in charge in Egypt. And the same thing with Daniel. Daniel was elevated to the second in charge in Babylon. My goodness. And so you can see that your gift will make room for you. That's a word for someone right now. Thank you, Father God, that whoever's watching today needs to hear that word. Your gift will make room for you. So Practice your gift. Use your gift. Don't let it stay dormant. Wow, thank you, Lord. That's the word. Sometimes we have gifts, but we're not actually employing them or using them. That's what I mean by practice the gift. It's actually using it is a better word, I should say. So when you employ or use your gift, whether it's a gift of prophecy or word of knowledge or speaking in tongues, interpretation of dreams and visions, all these things, it's a greatly needed gift in the body of Christ today. And that's why we want to train up people in the gifts of the Spirit this year. And that's why I'm excited, because as we enter into the end times pray through the return of the Messiah, we're going into the greatest revival the world has ever seen. Many souls will be saved and come into the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God will grow and expand and flourish like a palm tree. Praise God. We declare that over your life as well. Psalm 92:12. And I shouldn't say forget about it, but don't be distracted by all the negativity and all the darkness going on in the world, because the light is shining brighter. Whoa, praise God. I just see the flick of the switch, like the light. It only takes just a flick of a switch for the light of Christ to come and dispel all the darkness. Praise God. I rebuke and cast all darkness out of your life, all lies, all deception, all negativity. Go in Jesus' mighty name. Let the fire of God, the fire of the Holy Spirit consume everything in your life that is not of Him, and let the light be turned on. My God, thank you, Lord, that you are light and in you is no darkness at all. Praise God. Hallelujah. This is a seer's anointing that I like to work in, because that's where I feel comfortable. See, when you have a gift, it comes effortlessly, so you can operate in that gift without striving, if that's the right word. God says in Psalm 46:10, be still and know that I am God. So we need to be at peace. Hallelujah. Shalom, peace. And shalom means more than peace. It's prosperity, well-being. It means a lot. But God wants us to operate out of that shalom, peace of the third heaven. And you will see great things happen in your life this year. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. Where were we going here? 2 Corinthians chapter 12. This is Apostle Paul. And this is the vision that I had. A similar experience as Apostle Paul had, which is the reason why we named our ministry Third Heaven. It says, verse 4, I must go on boasting. Verse 1, 2 Corinthians chapter 12, says, I must go on boasting, although there is nothing to be gained. I will go on to visions. Everyone say visions and revelations from the Lord. So again, revelation and visions are all part. Someone type it into the comments. Thank you for sharing with your friends and family. We want to reach as many people as possible. And you're all part of the Third Heaven family. We love you all. We say God bless you. Thank you for watching and supporting us in prayer and financially in many ways. We're so grateful. Thank you. Verse 2 says, I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven. It's the only time in Scripture where the heaven or the place where God dwells is called the third heaven. Most times people just call it heaven or the heavens. But it's really the third heaven is the place where God dwells. The sky above us is the first heaven. And in between, there's a place called the second heaven, which is not explicitly mentioned in Scripture. But when you do the study on it, you'll see that it's just logical. When you have a first and a third, there has to be a second in between. But the third heaven is the place where God dwells in unapproachable light. And Apostle Paul was caught up to heaven. There's only two apostles ever had this experience that's written in Scripture. Many people have had these experiences probably since, but we only have it written in Scripture twice, which is Apostle Paul here, and then in John chapter 4 and 5, Apostle John gives us an amazing description of the throne room of God in the pattern of heavenly worship. And that's so crucial, because that's part of the revelation God has given me, which I will share next week on the vision for third heaven going forward, and why we need your support, why we need partners, why we need even people who see the vision and want to invest in the vision, because there's going to be eternal rewards for all of us who are participating in allowing God's kingdom to come where? On earth as it is in heaven. God has given us that mandate to do that. Praise the Lord. So Apostle Paul said he was caught up to the third heaven, whether it was in the body or out of the body, I do not know, but God knows. A lot of people have this experience and they feel like it's an out-of-body experience because they feel like their spirit leaves their body and goes up to the third heaven, but their physical body remains on earth, because heaven is a spiritual place. Flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. In heaven, the people, yes, they have a spiritual body, and they look like, you know, the way we look here on earth, but it's not flesh, it's spirit. My God, thank you, Lord God, that God is spirit, and those who worship him will worship in spirit and in truth. And there's a lot, lots of visions we're going to share on the third heaven in the coming weeks and months. And it says here, what, and I know that this man, of course, Paul is talking as if it was someone else, but we believe it's really him who was caught up to the third heaven. He says, as I know that this man, whether in the body or apart from the body, I do not know, but God knows, was caught up to paradise. So now he uses another name called paradise, and we'll get into the different names of the third heaven and paradise. And he says, I heard inexpressible things, things that no one is permitted to tell. I will boast about a man like that, but I will not boast about myself except about my weaknesses. Even if I should choose to boast, I would not be a fool because I would be speaking the truth, but I refrain so no one will think of me than is, so no one will think more of me than is warranted by what I do or say, or because of these surpassingly great revelations. Praise God. So the Apostle Paul had these surpassingly great revelations, as well as the Apostle John and many of us, because God said he's pouring out his spirit on all flesh. And so this should be normal in the body of Christ today. God is a supernatural God, and supernatural signs, wonders, and miracles should be commonplace. It should be natural for us who are part of the kingdom of God, because our spirit is actually seated in heavenly places. My God, thank you, Father God, for that revelation. When you're born again of the Spirit, your spirit is actually seated in heavenly places. And yes, we're still here on the earth physically, but our spirit has direct access to the third heaven, to our heavenly Father. And that's why we've been adopted with the Spirit. They can cry, Abba, Father. We don't even have to call God by his first name, because we can call him Abba, which means dad or daddy or father. And that's the personal relationship God wants with you, a more intimate, deeper relationship. And that comes through worship. And again, that's where the revelation I received this week is that worship will be a very crucial part of going forward and establishing God's tabernacle here upon the earth, the pattern of his worship. Praise God. So that's all I'm going to share on visions today. The Apostle Paul had a powerful vision there, and John had some great visions and revelations, the whole book of Revelations, one big powerful visions in Daniel and Joseph. But let's turn to the very first time we see the word dreams in the Bible. And the reason why this is important, because dreams and visions go together, but there's something called the law of first occurrence or first instance, which means whenever you're doing a study in the Word of God, the Scriptures, we should go back to the book. Usually the book of Genesis is it's the book of beginnings. So any word you're looking for, you will most likely always find it first in Genesis. And so let's go to Genesis chapter 20. And this is the first time the word dream is used. And it's incredible. The first time the word dream is used, it's not about Abraham, Isaac, or Jacob. It's about a Gentile king named Abimelech. And it's amazing. He was the king of Egypt. And it says here now in Genesis chapter 20, verse 1. Now Abraham moved on, on from there into the region of the Negev and lived between Kadesh and Shur. For a while he stayed in Gerar, and there Abraham said of his wife Sarah, she is my sister. Then Abimelech, king of Gerar, sent for Sarah and took her. But God came to Abimelech in a dream one night and said to him, you are as good as dead because of the woman you have taken. She is a married woman. Now isn't this incredible that God appears in a dream to Abimelech and he actually speaks to him? So a lot of times in your dreams you can actually hear God speaking to you. It's not necessarily an audible voice, even though some prophets do hear God audibly. A lot of times it's your inner voice, still small voice. And in a dream, you can actually hear God speak. But it's a Gentile king here, and now Abimelech had not gone near her. So he said, Lord, will you destroy an innocent nation? Did he not say to me, she is my sister? And didn't she also say, he is my brother? I have done this with a clear conscience and clean hands. So now Abimelech is having a conversation with God. He may not even be saved. He's a Gentile king, but yet God is speaking to him, and he's actually speaking back to God in the dream. And then it says in verse 6, then God said to him in the dream, yes, I know you did this with a clear conscience, and so I have kept you from sinning against me. That is why I did not let you touch her. Now return the man's wife, for he is a prophet, and he will pray for you, and you will live. But if you do not return her, you may be sure that you and all who belong to you will die. Early the next morning, Abimelech summoned all his officials, and when he had told them all that had happened, they were very much afraid. And then Abimelech called Abraham and said, why have you done this? So you can read the whole chapter. Sorry for rushing, but I want to get to some other very specific dreams in the Bible. But it's amazing here that Abimelech spoke to God in his dream, and it was a clear dream. He heard the voice, and he responded, and he did. He was obedient. My God, this was a warning. God gave him a warning, and you'll see later, God appears to Pharaoh in a dream, and Joseph interprets it. So God can speak to anyone. Doesn't matter who you are. God raised up Cyrus to do a mighty work for the Israelites in the Old Testament. And you'll see the next instance of dreams. It's before Joseph. It's in Genesis chapter, where are we here? Genesis chapter 28, I believe. Hold on. Praise God. Thank you, Lord God. Genesis chapter 28. Hallelujah. I love this because, you know, we see Abimelech in Genesis 20. Now, Jacob has a dream in Genesis 28. He's the second person where the word dream is used in the Bible. And it says here in verse 10, Jacob left Beersheba and set out for Haran. And when he reached a certain place, he stopped for the night because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones there, he put it under his head and lay down to sleep. He had a dream in which he saw a stairway resting on earth and its top reaching to heaven. And the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. There above it stood the Lord, and he said, I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham and the God of Jacob. I will give you and your descendants the land on which you are lying. Your descendants will be like the dust of the earth, and you will spread out to the west and to the east, to the north and to the south. All the peoples on the earth will be blessed through you and your offspring. That's amazing right there. That just goes to show you that God did promise the land of Israel to Jacob's descendants. And Jacob's name was later changed to Israel. Was Jacob a Jew at this time? That's like a trick question, because we call Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob the patriarchs of the Jewish people. But really, his name had not been changed yet to Israel. And so technically, he's not really, how can I say this? He's not really a Jew yet. He's a Gentile. But we're still calling Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob the patriarchs of the nation of Israel. The nation was birthed through Jacob in a few chapters later, and then the tribe, 12 tribes of Israel come into existence. The reason I love the book of Genesis, it has nothing to do with the law or the Mosaic law, which came later, 500 years later, in 1400 BC plus, when Moses wrote the Torah, and all the Ten Commandments and the laws all came in the book of Genesis. So, in the book of Exodus. But Genesis predates the Mosaic law. And you'll see there's a lot of Gentiles that God is dealing with and speaking to. And technically, if you think about it, the Jews came out of the Gentile people. It's hard to grasp that, but you have to understand that Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob predate the nation of Israel. And then finally here, where am I going there? So how can this be true that God will bless all the nations of the world through Jacob's offspring or descendants? It's through the Messiah. The Messiah, the Son of God, is the one who brought both Jew and Gentile, which is the whole world, into one body. And that's how the whole world was blessed, through a descendant of Jacob, the Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Holy Anointed One of Israel. Amen. Now, he says here, I am with you and will watch over you wherever you go, and I will bring you back to this land. I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. When Jacob woke up from his sleep, he thought, surely the Lord is in this place, and I was not aware of it. He was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God. This is the gate of heaven. I love that song. You are awesome in this place, mighty God. You're awesome in this place, Abba Father. Praise God. It's an awesome song. But he had this experience of like just awe that He woke up from a dream and he said, my God, God is in this place. It was so real and tangible, the dream he had. And God uses dreams very often. You'll see again later in the New Testament when he speaks to Joseph to take Mary and Jesus and go to Egypt, another warning dream. God speaks, it uses the angels too. Gabriel is a messenger angel, and God uses the angels in dreams to speak clearly to his people. And here, what does Jacob do as a result of this dream? This was a life-transforming experience. He says, this is none other than the house of God. This is the gate of heaven. Early the next morning, Jacob took a stone he had placed under his head and set it up as a pillar and poured oil on top of it. So now he's creating an altar out of honor and respect and worship unto God. He called this place Bethel, though the city used to be called Luz. My God, one dream caused the city to be changed from Luz to Bethel, and put Jacob on the right course to become changed, later have his name changed to Israel and birth the 12 tribes of Israel. Praise God. Then Jacob made a vow. This is very interesting. By the way, some people call this a stairway to heaven or Jacob's ladder, but it had such a profound effect on Jacob that he made a vow saying, if God will be with me and will watch over me on this journey I am taking, and I will give him and will give me food to eat and clothes to wear so that I return safely to my father's household, then the Lord will be my God, and this stone I have set up as a pillar will be God's house. And of all that you give me, I will give you a tenth. So again, my goodness, here we have one dream which has a total life-changing impact for Jacob, because now he's making a vow. And inner vows are very important. If we make a vow to God and don't keep it, now we need to repent and be free of that inner vow. My goodness, someone needs to be delivered and set free from making a vow to God. If you have not kept your vow, you just repent and say, God, I'm sorry, and please forgive me, and God will give you another chance. But if you make a vow, it's a covenant with God. It's a serious thing. And Jacob said that if you bless me, God, then I will bring you a tenth of everything. Now, there's another, that's another word for tithe. Again, we talked about this last week, and we always go back to Abraham and Melchizedek in Genesis chapter 14. But I just want to take this moment here to talk a little bit about the importance of tithe and offering, which predates the Mosaic Law, because this had nothing to do with fruits and vegetables. This has to do 100% with everything you give me. He says, I will give you one tenth. So that's a vow Jacob made. And if Jacob is truly the father of Israel and the father of the 12 tribes of Israel, then you can realize that this kingdom principle can work for anyone who applies it. That's the way I understand the word of God. And I've seen it many times over. When you make a covenant with God and you do your part, God is faithful to do his part. God never fails. Praise God. That's what I love about it. God will always do his part. But the point is, are we going to keep our part? So I repent now, Father, for any disobedience in our lives. Forgive us, Father God, if we've ever missed the mark. I know you've appeared to many people in dreams and visions, but continue to do it, Lord God, and let them hear your voice clearly and then be obedient. Thank you, Lord. That's the word God is getting across to me now, is we need to be obedient to what he's asking us to do, and then the blessings will flow. Praise God. Deuteronomy 28:1-14. Hallelujah. I love this because, you know, we need to understand that God is a spirit and he has a spiritual language. Yes, God has given us his word in human language, human form, but God is a spirit, and we have to understand how he speaks in the spiritual language. And by the way, God will speak to you even in the human language that you understand. God will not speak to you in Hebrew if you don't understand Hebrew. God is smart enough to know that he can only communicate with you on the level of language that you understand, human language, that is. But dreams and visions, it goes beyond, because it's pictures. Thank you, Lord God. A vision to me is if you close your eyes and you see a picture, or like, let's say, a blackboard, and you see writing on the board, that's, I could see the word health right now. Praise God. Healing, health, prosperity. I can see those words written in white on the blackdrop or blackboard. And that's when you envision in your mind. It's like almost an imagination. Let me give you another example. There's a beautiful song here. We'll come back to dreams, but I just want to share with you the lyrics of one of the most popular Christian songs ever written. It is called I Can Only Imagine by Mercy Me. And many of you have seen the movie last year. It was one of the, a great movie. I recommend everyone check it out. I believe it's out on DVD now. I Can Only Imagine by Mercy Me. It's based on the song lyrics. And I'm going to read to you the lyrics of the song. It says, I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? As soon as I read that, I think of Psalm 46:10. Be still and know that I am God. He continues on the next verse. Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. And that's the three verses in the chorus. And then he repeats it over again. And he finally finishes by saying, I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine. Praise God. That song came out, wow, I think 1999 or 2001, somewhere in that time frame. It was one of the most popular Christian songs ever. But what he's saying is he's imagining what heaven will be like, what the third heaven will be like, and what will he do when he comes into the presence of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And it's a beautiful song. You can meditate and listen on it. But imagination is one way you can get a vision from God. God speaks to our spirit. Our spirit is down here. Our mind is up here. But the mind and the spirit are very closely related. So that's how I see vision. Sometimes I'll see a rainbow, and God is reminding me that the rainbow is a covenant blessing. That's what it means, that God is a covenant-keeping God, and there's a blessings attached with that rainbow, or a waterfall is showing overflowing blessings, health, wealth, prosperity. It's good things. There's pictures God can show you. What else? there's all sorts of pictures you can see. And then colors as well, like blue is a color of heaven, purple is a color of royalty, gold, you know, streets of gold in heaven, that's a picture of wealth, and many other things you can see. And we're going to get into all this prophetic, seers, anointing, and gifting, but I just wanted to share that the lyrics of that song there to make us understand how you can see visions is... sometimes, yes, it's good to close your eyes so you can kind of see into the spirit realm. You have to pray and be in right relationship with God and make sure that what you're hearing and seeing is from Him. And now I just got John 10. This is how we know that we're hearing from God. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. John chapter 10. Go there with me for a minute. As we leave Genesis on dreams, we're going to go to John chapter 10. And then I'm going to call on Andrea to come up and pray for everyone, anyone watching today who needs to hear a word from the Lord. And wow, I have so many notes on this. Praise God. Where are we here? We've got, we talked about the colors. White is purity. It signifies, white robes in Revelation signifies purity. Rivers is a good thing. You can have rivers of love, rivers of peace. Open fields, praise God. Psalm 23 talks about green pastures. I love that. Sometimes when I'm praying in prayer intercession, I see big, wide open fields, just green pastures. And I believe God is saying to someone today that you're coming into a wide, spacious place. Hallelujah. That means freedom. My God. See, we have to learn how to interpret the word of God. God just wants you to experience freedom and liberty. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Praise God. And liberty. Hallelujah. And it's just, again, a place of peace. Hallelujah. Psalm 23 says that the Lord is our shepherd, we shall not want. He makes us to lie down in green pastures and still waters. Hallelujah. What a beautiful picture of peace. And those psalms were birthed out of worship. And that's what I'm going to get into again next week, is that King David had a vision from heaven, and he established his tabernacle on earth to worship God 24/7. And he had hundreds, I think it was 288 musicians and singers. He had, as the king of Israel, he had the wealth to invest in hiring full-time musicians, singers, for the choir and prophetic, talented, anointed musicians. And we're going to get into the importance of why worship unveils God's plan and purposes for the earth, and why we need to have prophetic worship to be able to fulfill God's plan and purpose upon the earth. And King David had the vision from heaven on the importance of worship. So Psalm 23 was birthed out of all those musicians worshiping, Asaph and many others. There was four leaders in his tabernacle, and he had actually, I think it's 12 worship teams. Is that right? 12 worship teams, or maybe it was 24. Next week we're going to get into the tabernacle David set up. He had 24 worship teams and 12 members on each worship team. That's how you get the number 288 worshipers. I mean, it's amazing. And so today, what we're believing is that if you feel... I'm praying and believing for partners who want to establish God's tabernacle upon the earth. And it takes not only time and effort, but it takes resources, mainly finances. Like I said, King David had the finances because he was the king of Israel, that he could spend it, what's the equivalent of $30 million per month, to have nonstop worshipers worshiping day and night. And that's what brought heaven down into Israel. And it was the most amazing thing that the earth has ever experienced, that during the reign, 40-year reign of King David, my God, the worship was going continually, and Israel was united, praise God. Even under King Solomon, it was still united, and it was the wealthiest point in Israel's history, and he was able to construct the first temple. But because Solomon did not follow, in my opinion, did not follow the exact pattern of the worship that King David, his father, had established, I believe this is what caused him to follow, to get distracted. My God, thank you, Lord God, for keeping us from all distraction today. And he went after all false gods and false idols. And this is the only way to protect us of all the distractions going on in the world. We need to have 24/7 worship going up to God from the earth, which is mimicking what's happening in Revelation 4 and 5. Again, I jumped ahead there, but I'm too excited. But what God has shown me this week, and we're going to unpack this revelation and vision and pray it through. We need an implementation team. We need strategy team. We need prayer intercessors to rise up and help establishing and bringing to fruition what God has shown us prophetically in the spirit realm. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for all these signs and symbols. And let's turn to where are we going? John chapter 10. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. We're going to wrap it up in prayer, Andrea, so get ready. It says, very truly, I tell you, Pharisees, anyone who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other way, is a thief and a robber. It says, John chapter 10, verse 1. And then verse 2 says, the one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him because they do not recognize a stranger's voice. Before I continue, there's many warnings in the Old Testament, which I'll cover again next week because of timing, that even if someone is accurate in the prophetic word they're giving to you, they could even maybe interpret your dreams and visions. But if they are leading you astray into other gods, you have to reject them. And I'll show you where it says that in Deuteronomy. But the point is, it's someone who is leading you to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the Messiah, they are a true prophet. So again, it's not only the accuracy of the dream or vision or the interpretation, but it's, are they following the one and only true God? That's the most important thing. Otherwise, we have to reject what is not of God. But verse 6 says, Jesus used this figure of speech, but the Pharisees did not understand what he was telling them. Therefore, he said again, very truly, I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who have come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep have not listened to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. So again, the Messiah is the gate that we must enter in to be saved and enter into the third heaven. And he says, they will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy, but I have come that they may have life and life to the full or more abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. Then the wolf attacks and the flock. Then the wolf attacks the flock and scatters it. The man runs away because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep and my sheep know me. That's the important thing. If you're truly born again of the Spirit, if you're truly a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach, if you believe in God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Yahweh, Elohim, Adonai, El Shaddai, all these wonderful names of God, then you will hear his voice and you should be hearing his voice. That's the personal relationship we have with God through prayer. And it's very important because as we enter into these end times, yes, there will be a great revival. We'll see great things that God is doing. But at the same time, when persecution comes, we need to be ready and prepared to say, I will never, ever deny my faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Because if we come to that point, you know, that will determine, are we going to, when testing comes on our, against our faith, we need to know that we are children of God. And that's why the early Christians were willing to give their life and be martyred. And that's the thing that today we have it very easy in some parts of the world. In other parts of the world, my God, there's people being persecuted in China and in different countries, Middle East. And we need to pray for the persecuted church today because they are willing to give up their life for this amazing gospel, for this amazing a plan of salvation, and for the God, the Creator, my God, the Creator of the heavens and the earth. And so I'm challenging all of us to get ready that, yes, as we go into a time of great revival and worship this year, get ready for if any persecution against your faith, you need to hear the voice of God and be obedient, and you are all overcomers, praise God, by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. He continues on to say, I have other sheep that are not of the sheep pen. I must bring them also. So there's more sheep coming into the sheep pen that are not there yet. They too will listen to my voice, and there shall be one flock and one shepherd. Praise God. I love the fact that God is pouring out a spirit, like he said, on all flesh. There's many Muslims around the world having dreams of Jesus and are being saved and born again, as well as Hindus and Buddhists and different people of all different faiths and religions. Even many Jews are accepting the Lord Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, as their Messiah. And it's amazing. When I went to Trinidad and Tobago many years ago, there was a lady at the Toronto airport that heard me praying with my pastor friend. God bless you, Pastor Kamal Singh from Scarborough, if you're watching. And she says to us, oh, wait, I heard you praying. And she says, I was born in Trinidad and you know, I come from a Hindu background, but I had five dreams of the man in the white robe. And she says, I've never read the Bible, but I know it was Jesus who appeared to me. And the last time, the fifth time he appeared in the dream, he says, you must be born again. So she says, I heard you praying and I know you're men of God. And I just want to know, what do I have to do to be born again? And so we led her in the salvation prayer. It's just a simple prayer, which says, I acknowledge that I'm a sinner. I receive your free gift of forgiveness and grace, and God welcomes you into, God is faithful to forgive anyone who's willing to receive by grace that gift of salvation. Praise God. And so we led her in the salvation prayer. I had so many other experiences, but it's amazing how God spoke to her in a dream and many other people. So people who are willing to listen, God will speak to them. If you're seeking for truth, you will find it. And then finally in verse 18, it says, the reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life only to take it up again. So the reason the Messiah, the Son of God, was loved by the Father is that he was willing to lay down his life only to pick it up again. On the third day he rose again. He says, no one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This command I receive from my Father. The Jews who heard these words were again divided. Many of them said, he is demon-possessed and raving mad. Why listen to him? But others said, these are not sayings of a man possessed by a demon. Can a demon open the eyes of the blind? And so again, this is the reaction. The way you react to the Lord Jesus Christ will determine your eternity. Either you will experience heaven forever or you will experience hell forever. It's eternal damnation. It's separation from God. And the reason why I believe we need to pray now more than ever and preach the gospel and be bold in our faith and in our witness is that a lot of people think because of their religion, they're believing in God, but unfortunately they're believing a false God, because the only way God has made salvation possible for every person on earth is through his son, Jesus Christ. That was the gift. That was God's sacrifice, the Lamb of God who takes away all the sins of the world. So if you do not receive that free gift of grace and that sacrifice that God did for us, there's no other room for salvation. And so you cannot go to heaven. So you could be deceived right now. And Father, I pray the scales fall off the eyes of everyone watching today. And for anyone who feels that this is the moment they want to accept the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, just raise your hand. Even if you're watching at home, just as an act of faith, raise up your right hand or both hands and just say, Father God, I surrender all my life to you today. I repent of my sin. I receive your forgiveness. I receive your free gift of grace. And I give you my life. I thank you for filling me with your spirit, helping me to be born again. Thank you, Father God. I give you all the praise, glory, and honor in Jesus' name. If you've just said that prayer, all you have to do is call upon the name of the Lord and you shall be saved. But that prayer is a prayer of submission. It's a prayer of repentance. And that's what God is looking for, that we can just come before him humbly and receive his free gift of grace. Praise God. Andrea, if you're ready to pray or you have a word of knowledge, let's do that and wrap it up early today, because I want to leave time for more worship here in the sanctuary and we can seek God's face. If you want to participate in the fasting and prayer for these next 21 days, please contact us. And even if you just need prayer anytime, the number's right there. Feel free to call us for prayer. Andrea, you're very good at dreams and visions or interpretation, but if you just feel led to pray. Okay, I'm going to let you pray, and then I might have a word for someone online. God bless you all.
Thank you, Lord.
Father, we thank you, Lord God, that Father, even as I was sitting back there, Father, you began to download the scripture verse that says, trust in the Lord your God and lean not on your own understanding. Father, I pray for that one that is leaning on their own understanding. Father, I pray that they would trust you with all of their heart, Lord God, that they would love you with all of their soul, with all of their might, and with all of their power, Lord Jesus Christ. That, Father, that they would cast every single care upon you because you care for them. For, Father, your word says that your yoke is easy and your burden is light. Father, I thank you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth that, Lord God, you would continue, Lord Jesus Christ, to pour out your presence on your son and your daughter. Father, that you would continue to empower them, that, Father, whether they be a pastor, preacher, teacher, evangelist, apostle, whether they minister in the church, whether they're a stay-at-home mom or a dad that goes out to work, Father, we are all ministers of the gospel in some capacity. And Father, though some may never step on a pulpit, Father God, they are still ministering. They are ministering to their families. They are ministering to their children. They are ministering to their husbands and their wives and to their neighbors and to their co-workers, oh God. That Father, they are being that light in the darkness. Father, I pray in Jesus' name that, Father, as you give them instructions, as you lead and guide them, oh God, Father, I thank you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth that, Father, they would not lean on their own understanding. That when you give them that word of knowledge, Lord God, to speak to that individual, Lord, Father, though it may not make sense to us or it may not make sense to them in that moment, Father, I pray that they would be obedient, that as they speak that word, Lord God, Father, you know the heart and the mind of that individual. You know where they're at. You know what they're asking and you know what they're seeking for, Lord God. And Father, I thank you that that word that would be given to them would be a confirmation in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Father, I thank you. I thank you for who you are. I thank you for the higher heights and deeper depths that you're taking your people, oh God. That, Father, deep is calling on to deep. And, Father, I thank you that just as Joseph, Lord God, went ahead of his family to save their lives, Father God, what they meant for evil turned around for their good, that Israel would be saved, that his family would be saved, oh God. That, Father God, no matter where he was, Lord God, you were with him. Father, I thank you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth for that gift of Joseph. And Father God, also there is the gift of Daniel to interpret dreams as well, Lord God. Father, I thank you that you gave them that gift. And Father God, just as you gave them that gift, Father, you also give those gifts unto us. Father, I thank you that those gifts would be used for your kingdom purposes, Lord Jesus Christ. Amen and amen.
Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. The word I was getting before Andrew came up to pray, thank you, Father God. I believe it's for Linda, if you're watching today, all the way up in Alaska. We're complaining about cold weather here, but I know the temperature gets, according to our Celsius, it would be minus 10 or 20 probably, but thank you, Father God, for the fire of the Holy Spirit. The word I believe, Linda, God has for you today is that sometimes you may feel like you're not having as big an impact as you would like, but I would like to know that you are having a great impact. Praise God, because God actually used you to speak to me about the fire burning on the altar 24/7. My goodness, I see it again now, like you're putting, I believe it's wood in the word, wood burning stove, my God. Thank you, Father God, that as many people in the natural are putting wood in the stove to keep the heat burning all the time. Thank you, Father God, that people will start creating their spiritual altar. Thank you, Father God. You need to have a prayer room. What an awesome movie, prayer, a war room. Thank you, Father God, that people will establish their prayer altar, their war room in the spirit, Father God, and there should be fire at all times burning on the altar. Thank you, Father God, that as part of the vision for third heaven, Lord God, you will continually be through prayer, intercession, and worship, Lord God, there will be continual fire burning on the altar this year, Father God, so we can bring you all the praise, glory, and honor, Father, in your holy name. Amen and amen. Praise God. If there's anyone else has a prayer request, now is the time to let us know before we go offline. And I'm going to share one more scripture verse as we're getting there. Praise God. Hallelujah. We started off on Genesis. Okay, Genesis 28 was Jacob's dream about he saw the stairway to heaven and then God, the Lord, at the top of, in the difference here, that's the revelation I want to share. Earlier on in Genesis chapter 11, I believe it was, there was a Tower of Babel. Now, men were all speaking one language at the time. We don't know if it was Hebrew, but it said God confused the languages after Genesis chapter 11. So we don't know what the language they were speaking, where they could all communicate as one. But because man was trying to build this tower up to heaven, it was based on their pride, and it was in the natural. That's the point God is trying to share or show us. That when Jacob had this dream of a stairway to heaven and the angels going up and down, he saw the Lord at the top. So the difference here now is that God is raising up a people who will be in covenant relationship with him and will lean on him. That's the relationship God wants with us. It's not that we can do it on our own strength, but we have to mount up with wings as eagles, as he said, and let the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, lead us and guide us and take us up into the higher heights and deeper depths. And when I was reading that dream that Jacob had this week, I also realized that the Messiah said something on his trial just before his crucifixion, which is so powerful. It's found in Luke 22, verse 66 to 71, Matthew 26, 61 to 65, and then finally Mark 14, 58, 63. So I just want to turn there as we wrap up today, Mark 14. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Praise God, we exalt your word above all things today, Lord. Hallelujah. Mark 14. It says here that this is the trial before the Sanhedrin. They took the Messiah to the high priest and all the chief priests, the elders and the teachers of the law came together. Peter followed him at a distance right into the courtyard of the high priest. There he sat with the guards and warmed himself at the fire. The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for evidence against Jesus so that they could put him to death, but they did not find any. And many testified falsely against him, but their statements did not agree. Verse 57, then some stood up and gave this false testimony against him. We heard him say, I will destroy this temple made with human hands, and in 3 days I will build another not made with hands. Yet, even then, their testimony did not agree. Verse 60, then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus, are you not going to answer? What is this testimony that these men are bringing against you? But the Messiah remained silent and gave no answer. Finally, again, the high priest asked him, are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One? And he replied, I am. So right here in Scripture, we have an acknowledgement by Jesus Christ of Nazareth, Yeshua HaMashiach, saying, yes, I am the Messiah, the Son of God. And you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven. My God, that's the best declaration we have in Scripture, that he's more or less, I believe, fulfilling Jacob's dream, saying, I am the one seated at the right hand of the Most High God, and I will come on the clouds of heaven. And the high priest tore his clothes and said, why do we need any more witnesses? He asked, we have heard the blasphemy. What do you think? Now, he thought it was blasphemy, but he was actually telling the truth, that he is the Son of God, and those that receive it will experience eternal life. My God. And I just love the fact that we see in Scripture over and over again that the New Testament fulfills everything written in the Old. And so next week, we're going to get more into dreams and visions, part two, and we'll get into specific dreams that Pharaoh had and Daniel had. And you have a revelation, Andrea?
No. Annette Miller's asking for prayer for her family.
Okay. Praise God. Father, we pray for Annette. We lift her up to you right now, Lord God. I pray for strength and healing and peace, Lord God, and assurance. Thank you, Lord God. Assurance of your salvation. Praise God. That's what I'm getting for you, Annette, today, is that you need to have assurance of your salvation, that heaven is a better place to be than here on earth. Heaven is a place, and I'll share it in the next few weeks, where there's no pain, no sorrow, no sickness, no poverty. It's streets of gold. It's perfect fellowship with our Creator and with all the other saints in heaven. It's a much better place to be. But we're here on earth for a time and a purpose. And that's a revelation God is sharing for you, which I believe is blessing many others as well. Is that be at peace, be encouraged. Father, I thank you for filling her with the power, love, and a sound mind and your Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord God, that your Holy Spirit is her greatest encourager. And we have to do the best we can to establish God's kingdom. Father, I pray you establish your kingdom in her life there in Jamaica today, Father God. And just overflow, fill that house to overflowing with love and joy and peace. Thank you, Father God. Shalom, peace. Open up the windows of heaven and pour out a river of peace, Lord God. And I declare that by your stripes, she is healed and made whole. We send forth your word for healing, Lord God. But more importantly, let the glory of God surround her. Send her ministering angels, Father God, to minister to her, Father, and bring her shalom, total healing, restoration, and peace in your mighty name. Amen and amen. Praise God. Wow. Here on earth, all we can do is our best to create the pattern of heaven that King David saw in a vision, and that which Apostle John confirmed in Revelation 4 and 5. And I believe all the churches of today should be focusing on whether the foundation they've built on is it truly the pattern that God has given from the Spirit. And I'll share more on that next week. But what I'm saying is the third heaven is beyond anything we can ever have on earth. No matter we have these beautiful mountaintops and beautiful rivers and oceans and all beautiful nature God has created, it still pales in comparison to the true colors of heaven, the gardens of heaven, the tree of life, all the beautiful things, the mansions God has created for each and every one of you in the third heaven. It's a place of just no sin, no evil. So can you imagine just total joy, love, peace, peace, love, joy, whichever way you word it, and just, my God, there's no ways to explain it. I pray, Father, for everyone watching today that they will have a third heaven visitation and a third heaven experience in their life and an encounter with you, Lord God. You are the one who is, the third heaven is all about you, Father God. They need to have an encounter with you, Father, and your love and your light and your joy and your peace will flow into their lives this day. Hallelujah. In your mighty name, amen. Peter had a great vision in Acts chapter 10, which I'll cover next week. Any other prayer requests, Andrea? Okay, we're going to wrap it up, but I just want to go back to, thank you, Father God. We finished 2018 right on target for those of you that have been helping support us. We did not have a financial surplus, but we did not have a financial deficit. And I'm just going to share that because I'm very open and transparent that we managed to start Third Heaven Ministry, how can I say this, on a very... I don't want to use the word small budget, but on a very in the most economical way possible. Let me put it that way. But we're believing for much more than that. I'm very happy that we managed to have everything paid for, the sound system, the what do you call it, the musicians or the mixer, speakers, everything that's included with the sound system and the sanctuary. Praise God. There's a cost, even internet and phone and laptop, all the technology required to make Third Heaven happen. God has blessed us for 2018, but we have a much greater vision for 2019, and that's to help feed the orphans and the widows and do much more of the kingdom work. And that requires support financially. And that's why I'm calling on all of you watching today. If you've been touched in any way by Third Heaven Ministries, I feel God is telling me I need to just be more firm in making people realize that a lot of your blessings are tied, or I don't want to use the word tied up, but they can be released through the law of sowing and reaping. And God is saying, he's told me is that some of your blessings have been withheld because you have not applied God's kingdom principles of sowing and reaping. And as you sow, that will allow you to reap what God has for you. And I'm only telling you this is because I want to see you all blessed and experience the abundant life of God. But when I hear God say that people are missing out on a lot because they're not following his word, it's like, my God, we have to repent of that. We have to say, sorry, God, for lack of faith and for allowing spirit, Father, I cast out all spirit, perfect love, cast out all of fear. Thank you, Lord. And you have to have a boldness and a confidence saying, I'm going to sow a seed into God's kingdom, which will bring a harvest. That's the way farmers think, is they're going to put a lot of seed out expecting the harvest to come. And so these are kingdom principles that God has put in place. And I just, again, it's a short teaching on offering. I want to see everyone blessed is the reason why we're doing it. But we also want to establish his kingdom in a much greater measure this year. By the way, I do not take any salary from Third Heaven Ministries. So everything you give to Third Heaven, me, my wife, she's been great on the administration side. We have volunteered all our time. We work Monday to Friday. And imagine that everything we did in Third Heaven so far has been on a part-time basis. I work Monday to Friday. She does as well. My only day off is Saturday, which is my Shabbat. I take time to rest and spend time with the Lord. And sometimes I even end up not taking a full 24-hour Shabbat. But that's another story because Sunday is a work day for me as well. My God. So imagine if this is what we can do on a part-time basis. Imagine what we can do when we give ourselves full 100% focus into the kingdom of God. We can have great revival and do establish God's kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. So I'm asking and challenging all of you to fulfill God's plan and purpose in your life and to sow into God's kingdom, whether it's here or somewhere else. It will help unlock your blessings. But if you're connected and you're partnering with us, I believe great rewards are going to come to you. I've seen it happen in our lives this year. Father, I pray for all the needs and resources for people who are in business. I pray for their business to flourish this year and favor upon their business, upon their relationships and healing and restoration in marriages, Father God, and financial increase. Yes. And even those watching pastors, I bless your ministry. Yes. I thank you for unity. I declare unity in the body of Christ. that if when everyone starts to work together in unity, Lord God, a great blessings will be there for everybody, Lord, and the kingdom will grow and flourish and be established in a greater measure. Thank you all. God bless you all. We love you. We thank you for participating. And I'm excited. I just pray you can receive that excitement and that passion for what's about to happen. But we need partners, and we are calling upon you to partner with us to establish God's vision and kingdom this year. God bless you all. Shalom. We'll see you next week.